or stay in the masjid with the intention of becoming closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's etiquette. Spending some time in the masjid. So now, everybody here should renew their intention, both brothers and sisters. They should renew the intention that we're doing etiquette now. Shafi'i rahimahullah said he could do etiquette for 15 minutes. Today, mashallah, you're sitting here from 2 to maybe 9, 10, 11, 12, whatever, we'll finish inshallah. But not that long. But inshallah, have the intention now, renew your intention that this is i'tikaf. To give the reward for i'tikaf. And if you look at the page 227 at the bottom, it says, what is meant here to stay in the mosque? And I already said that this word is misused. Why, guys? You're a language professional. You cannot use the word mosque. Why? Exactly. That's where it came from. We say masjid. And people know masjid. When you spell it M-A-S-J-E-D. Like in mosque, it came from the word mosquito in French area, and this is how it started. They called the masjid mosque, like mosquito, meaning they didn't care about it. Then the Muslims, they just carried the word, they sound good for a masjid, so they just use it without even knowing where it came from or why it's used. So this is one of the words that I don't like the translation. If you want to write down masjid, write it down M-A-S-J-E-D. And by the way, even if you type it, people know it. People could read it and they know it's a masjid now. You don't need to write the word mosque, and I don't like it at all. So i'tikaf is to spend some time in the masjid for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not to show off. Not that people will say, mashallah, the brother has been here for best 10 days, and mashallah, he's doing very good. The subhanAllah, believe it or not, there is no such hadith about the virtue of i'tikaf. It's very famous that Rasulullah used to spend the last 10 days from Allah, and he recommended to the sahaba, and the companions recommended, and the ulama, they used to do it. And some of the ulama, they would do it even outside of Ramadan. They would say, I'm going to the masjid to spend half an hour or 1 hour to spend in the masjid to listen to a lecture. Let me have the intention of i'tikaf. Yes, there is a reward for it, but there is no specific virtue. Like if you do i'tikaf, this will happen. The only hadith I think that, or one of the hadith that says that if you do i'tikaf at the mosque of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then you get the intercession or something like that. That's not an authentic hadith. So there is no any hadith that show the virtue of doing i'tikaf, meaning spending time in the masjid. There is no virtue. Yes, there is general, like you come to the masjid, you're getting reward for every step that you take. You spend time in the masjid, the angels, they will send prayers upon you, meaning they will ask Allah to forgive you. Then you will have the mercy upon you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All that, but there is no specific narration for i'tikaf. Like it says, if you spend time in the masjid for i'tikaf, you will get 1,000 reward.
Isn't there a hadith that says that at the time you wait for salah, they come to the masjid and wait for the salah, you get that as if you were praying the entire time?
Very nice, but that's waiting for the salah. But I'm saying i'tikaf, meaning i'tikaf has a special intention. If you come from the masjid, if you come from home to the masjid to pray Maghrib, Maghrib is 8 o'clock, you're here at 7:30. From 7:30 to 8 o'clock, you're counted as if you're in the salah. Okay? But if you came without the intention of i'tikaf, meaning you came to pray, not to spend time in the masjid, you don't get the reward for i'tikaf. So there is no virtue that says, like, if you pray the night of Al-Qadr, then Allah will forgive your sins. If you spend the night of Al-Qadr as if you have spent 1,000 nights. If you do this, if you fast Ramadan, Allah will forgive your previous sins, right? There is no such hadith that says, if you do i'tikaf, like that. But in general, spending time in the masjid, you're getting reward for every second that you spend in the masjid for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you have to have an intention. Why? Because I might call Qais and be like, hey, we want to meet at the masjid, inshallah, 5 o'clock. We come to the masjid, we meet, we sit and talk, and then leave. Both of us are not getting any reward. But we stayed in the masjid. Yes, but we didn't have any intention of staying at the masjid. Our intention was that we're going to meet each other and maybe sit and talk. And sometimes we talk about dunya and talk about things that had nothing to do with the deen in the masjid, which is not recommended, because the masjid is for the ibadah, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the scholars agree that the Prophet وسلم, and this is of course proven by the hadith that the Prophet وسلم, would perform i'tikaf for the last 10 days of Ramadan. In the year he died, he performed it for the 20 days. Some ulama here discuss whether it's what is it, sunnah to do i'tikaf the last 10 days or the 20 days? Huh?
10 days.
This is what Rasulullah did all the time. The 20 days, he did it before he died. So that showed that it was for Rasulullah. It was something special for Rasulullah because he knew that he would die soon and this would be the end of his last Ramadan. How did he know that? And we already said nobody knows when he's going to die.
Revelation.
How? Allah didn't reveal to him that you're going to die like that year or that day. Nobody knows the exact date, but
I was going to say, I know a story of Musa al-Salam. I mean, they would come to him saying, are you ready to die?
At a time of death.
Yeah.
Okay. But I'm saying, how did he spend 20 days? That's not time of death. Jibreel came and he recited the Quran twice that year. Rasulullah saw that was a sign that my death is coming very soon. So he knew that this was his last Ramadan because Jibreel reviewed the Quran with him twice that year. Every year Jibreel would come down and Rasulullah would read the Quran to Jibreel. Like, you know how when you memorize, you go to a sheikh and you tell him, oh, I memorized this surah. So Jibreel would listen and Rasulullah would recite the whole Quran. But the last year, Ramadan, he recited twice. So he said that was a sign of my death. That's how he would know. That's why. I know you guys are waiting for this stuff. That's why some of the people in the sects and the hadith, they believe that some of the awliya, they know when you're going to die or the time that you're, like they could tell you, oh, I see that yesterday, and they have it in their books, like some of their wali, he told somebody that, he said, I seen something in my dream or something like that, and he told him, do good because you're gonna die soon. So he waited a month or so and he's not dead yet. So he said, well, the angel of death came to me and he told me and you are gonna die the same day. He wanted to tell the guy, don't worry, like, when I die, you'll die. So just wait. And he told him, how come he told me it's very soon? He said, well, the soon means that when I die, meaning because of the virtue. And then all these, I don't know how these people listen to them. And they say this stuff. How could you know when you're going to die? Nobody knows when he's going to die, ever. Even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the exact time, no. When Jibreel came to him, when the angel of death came to him, the Musa alayhi salam, when he came to him and he said, I'm coming to take your soul. What did he do?
He said, take me away.
Booked his eye with his finger. So the angel of death went back to Allah. See, even Musa didn't know that he was dying or else he wouldn't do that. So he went back to Allah and the hadith is narrated by Bukhari Muslim, by the way. So he went back to Allah and said, ya Allah, you have sent me to a man who doesn't want to die. He said, okay, go back to him and tell him that your time is over. So do you want to live or do you want to die? Like, you get a choice, to live or to die. So the angel of death came to Musa a second time and told him, Allah has given you a choice. Do you want to live or you want to die? He said, no, of course I want to die. I want to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What's the problem with this hadith? That some people say, how could he book the angel's eye? It seemed that the angel, when he came in the first time, he did not come in his form that Musa knew. No, Musa knew the angel. But when he came, he told him, I'm coming to take your soul. Imagine somebody's coming to your house, you open the door, and he said, I'm coming to take your soul. What are you going to do? Defend yourself. The second time when the angel came, he came in his form that Allah created him with. So he told him, and Allah is giving you a choice. So he knew he was the angel of God. First time he didn't know that. And if the shaitan, or the angel, but if the shaitan mainly, because the angel you cannot see no more, if the shaitan is transformed into something else, you could kill him. So if you have a snake, and the shaitan is the snake, or a lamb dog, and you kill that snake, you might kill a shaitan. You say, how can we kill the shaitan? You cannot kill the shaitan if he comes in his form, because you cannot see him in his actual form that Allah created him with. But if he transforms to something else, then you have the power to kill him, because he's tied to whatever he's transformed to. You got that? So this is what happened with Musa. And you know how Musa, he was very strong. Somebody coming to take his soul, he's not going to say, okay, go ahead and kill me. That's why we have in the sunnah, if somebody looks from your window or through your door without your permission, if you book his eye, you have to pay him nothing. Like if you're finding somebody and you book his eye, you have to pay him something, fidya, for it. But if he's like sneaking in, he's looking through your house, if you have something in your, a knife in your hand or something, and you push him, whatever happens to him, there's nothing upon you. Why? Because he didn't get permission to look into your house. So that's what happened with Musa. Somebody was looking in, coming to take your soul. They said, no, I'm not going to do it. Okay? That's the thing. So again, Rasulullah ﷺ reformed the i'tikaf for the past 20 days. And then his wife reformed the i'tikaf with him and continues to do after his death. Meaning they continued to do i'tikaf for the last 10 days. Here is something very important for the sisters. They could do i'tikaf, two conditions. If the two conditions are fulfilled, or sorry, three, let's make it three, make it hard on them. Three conditions. Number one, they have to come out of their house with proper dress. That's a must to come to the masjid. Number two, she has to have a company, somebody with her, somebody driving her, somebody giving her a ride, her father, her brother, her son, her husband, okay? Someone to be with her. She cannot just say, I'm driving at 2 o'clock in the morning to go to the masjid for the sake of Allah. Stay home for the sake of Allah. Because if something happened to you in the way, then we're going to be in trouble, okay? So she want to come to the masjid, somebody has to be with her, and he has to stay in the masjid with her. Because if she needs something, he's going to be the only one to actually talk to her and see what she wants. What do you say? The third? The third, she has to be in a place where men cannot see her in the masjid. Because at night, if she went to rest, or she take her time to sleep, or to rest for 1 hour to wake up to pray, she has her freedom, she has a free area to go around. But if in the masjid, men in the women in the back and men in the front, then I don't recommend that because of the mixing. If she sleeps, everybody when they sleep, you don't know what's covered and what's uncovered, what's going on. Even men, like if a woman is reading Quran and a man is reading, is laid down, his t-shirt is all the way up here, and he's like snoring all over, she looks around, his private is showing, that's not allowed. So if they have their own area where they could stay, then it's recommended for them to do i'tikaf. A lot of people think it's recommended for them to stay at home. This is the problem that we fall in. No, it's recommended for them to do i'tikaf because this is the sunnah of Rasulullah. If it was recommended for them to stay home, Rasulullah would tell his wife, stay home, don't come with me. He would tell the sahaba, don't come. But even after his death, if somebody says, Rasulullah was alive, that's why he took his wife. After his death, the wives of the Prophet used to do i'tikaf in the masjid the last 10 days of Ramadan till they died. So if your wife wants to come to i'tikaf, you should not stop her because there's two hadith. One, Rasulullah ﷺ took his wife to i'tikaf, so you cannot tell her no. Two, Rasulullah says, do not stop women from going to the masjid. Unless you have a very decent excuse, like you say, the masjid, you know, it's wide open and there's mixing between men and women, I'm not going to take you. Yeah, you have an excuse now. But if you have no excuse, then you have no right. Umar radiallahu anhu, he was so jealous, right? So jealous. And his wife knew that. But she used to go to the masjid, Maghrib, Isha and Fajr. So they told her, how could you go to the masjid and you know Umar was so jealous, you know, he doesn't like it. She said, why he can't stop me? They said, he can't stop you because there's a hadith that Rasulullah says, don't stop women from going to the masjid. And you know that Umar won't go against the hadith of the Prophet, that's why you're taking a chance. She said, yes. And he never stopped her till he died. Even though Umar, he would if he can. If there was no hadith, wallah, I think he would kill her if she go out, not just that. But he couldn't. And Isha and Fajr is like the darkest time to go to the masjid. So when she got married to Zubayr radiallahu anhu, Zubayr, he was so jealous too, but he did a trick. He hid it somewhere in the before the masjid, and she was going, so he tried to scare her at night, and he covered himself, and she didn't see him. So she went to home and she was crying. He said, what's going on? And she said, I'm never going to go to the masjid again. He said, why? You know, Rasulullah said you could go and all that. She said, no, people have changed. Time of Rasulullah, nobody would ever talk to me when I was walking. Now people are attacking me when I'm going to the masjid. Astaghfirullah, this is time of fitna. So she stopped going to the masjid. So he succeeded. But the thing is, you cannot stop women from going to the masajid if there is no excuse. That's the point. I'tikaf is the same thing. And listen, religion is not but what you think. Okay? It's not but what by what you like. It's by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said and what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. So you say, what are you talking about? You want our women to come to the masjid and spend the night? Yeah, I'm telling you to come to the masjid and spend the night. I'm not saying anything else. It's a masjid, and they spend the night praying and doing tarawih. Okay? Just have that in mind. Being strict on something that the deen allowed you to do is wrong. And being loose on things that the deen told you to be strict is wrong. So a lot of people, they do everything that you could imagine. And then you tell them something like that. What, the sheikh is trying to get a... Pay attention. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you cannot stop them from going to the masajid if they have these conditions. But if a woman goes out without hijab, having perfume on, full makeup, she want to come to the masjid, her husband must stop her from going to the masjid. See the difference now? I told you, he has no right to stop her. But if she comes out, she's not dressed properly, like according to the deen. She has makeup. She comes to the masjid and she doesn't care if men around or not around. The husband becomes a must for him to stop her now, because there is more fitna than benefit, and if there is more harm than benefit, then... You stop. You got it? No. So i'tikaf is divided into two parts, and all that you could read inshallah, I'm just trying to summarize. Page 228, i'tikaf is divided into two categories. Sunnah and Sunnah and obligatory. Okay? Sunnah and obligatory. The last 10 days of Ramadan or any time of the year, i'tikaf is a sunnah. I'tikaf is yes? Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Especially the last 10 days of Ramadan. Tayyid. When does i'tikaf? Anyone who doesn't know the word i'tikaf now, we already mentioned it 20,000 times. I'tikaf means to spend time in the masjid, okay? So you can come later and say, Shaykh, what was i'tikaf? With the intention of closing to Allah, not to show off, okay? Tayyib. When does i'tikaf become obligatory? If one person makes it obligatory upon himself. If one person makes it obligatory upon himself. For example, he says, Ya Allah, if you cure my son, I'll do i'tikaf for 20 days. That's called a nafi. You must fulfill that. That promise, you must fulfill. That's why Rasulullah said, An-nadhru la ya'ti bi khayr. It will never bring good. That promise that you make upon yourself, it will never bring you good. Because you could promise, oh, Ya Allah, if you cure my son, I will fast 60 days. Then you're 50, 60, 70, and you're like, oh man, I promised early to fast 60 days. I cannot even do it now. So what happened? Now you have a kafara. You have to pay, or you have to fast, you have to fulfill the promise somehow. So you're making it hard upon yourself. And I already told you, do not put a condition upon Allah. Don't say, Ya Allah, if you do this, I will do this. No, don't do that. Leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure your son without saying, Ya Allah, if I get all A's, inshallah I'm going to go do Umrah. What if you don't get A's? I'm not going to do Umrah because I didn't get it. What is that? You're forcing Allah to do something? You're putting a condition upon Allah? If you know that you cannot keep that promise, don't make it. النَّذْرُ شُؤْمُ لَا يَأْتِ بِخَيْرِ كَمَا قَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. So the... And some of the ulama, they said that نَذْرُ الْمُعَلَّقُ مَكْرُوبُ. Meaning if you put a promise to a condition, it's forbidden. Or it's dislike. Meaning to say, Ya Allah, if you do this, I will do this. It's dislike according to most of the ulama. And you have to fulfill your promise. But if you do a promise of committing a sin, then what should you do? You should not fulfill that promise. So you say, oh Allah, if I pass this test, I'm going to Las Vegas. I'm going to have some fun. Okay? Then you pass the test. You're like, that's it. I promise Allah, I cannot do it. If it's haram promise, of course, going to Vegas is not haram, but you know what I mean. Go to Vegas, of course. So if you do that promise, you do not have to fulfill. Like that's how they came to Rasulullah. They said, Ya Rasulullah, we promised when we were time before Islam that if this and this happened to us, we will sacrifice an animal for the idol. He says, that's haram promise, so do not fulfill it. Okay? Like the man, it's good to remind, just to make it easy, the man who said that, astaghfirullah, the man who said that, if Ya Allah, cure my son, please, he's very sick. And if you cure my son, I will fast 3 days for the sake. So Allah cured this son. So the man fasted 3 days. Then his son died. So he said, Ya Allah, okay, you do that to me? I'm going to subtract these 3 days from Ramadan. That's a haram nadr, number one. Okay? And you cannot subtract 3 days of Ramadan, by the way. You cannot do that. Having that promise, the ulama said, it's dislike. And the word dislike here means what? I know makruh. Close to?
Haram.
Because it's very hard, proven to be very hard, that you could actually fulfill that promise. For some reason, what if you get sick? What if you travel? What if you cannot? What if you don't have enough money? And that has to be the same way you said it. So if you said, Ya Allah, if you give me a baby, I will slaughter a goat. Then you come and say, let me slaughter a chicken. You cannot do that. And you say, I'm going to slaughter a camel because the camel is more expensive than the goat. You cannot do that. You have to slaughter a goat because that's what you said in the promise. So make it open. They say, Allah, inshallah, I will do something for the sake of Allah. That's it. Anything for the sake of Allah. But if you limit yourself, then you have to do exactly how you said it. Okay? And you cannot combine that. So if you said, Ya Allah, if you give me a baby or if you make me pass the test, I'll slaughter a goat for the sake of you. Then you come in Ramadan and Eid and you say, let me slaughter the nadr and the adhiyah or the aqiqah of my child and the promise. You cannot do that. It has to be fulfilled by itself. That's why i'tikaf, if you say, Ya Allah, I will spend some time in the masjid, you say it that way, I will spend some time in the masjid, then what happened? I'tikaf becomes obligatory. But when is it the sunnah?
The last 10 days.
Highly recommended in the last 10 days and any time of the year. Of the year. No. Okay. The ulama said, if... Okay, we'll get to it inshallah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Umar said, Ya Rasulullah, I made an oath to perform i'tikaf one night in the masjid, again mosque, at Mecca, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, fulfill your oath, meaning you have to do it, it becomes obligatory. Like 3.148, i'tikaf, the length of i'tikaf. The length of i'tikaf, the obligatory, is to be as long as the oath stated. So if he said, I will spend 30 minutes in the masjid, then you have to spend 30 minutes in the masjid. If you say, I'll spend 1 day in the masjid, then you have to spend 1 day in the masjid. If you say, Allah, alhamdulillah. If you say, Allah, I'll spend 3 hours, you have to spend 3 hours. The sunnah has no length. I'tikaf has no length, meaning that the last 10 days, if you spend 1 hour, it's considered to be i'tikaf. 5 minutes, it's considered to be i'tikaf. 15 minutes, it's considered to be i'tikaf. Any time that you spend, but not coming in and out of a masjid. Like you're crossing by East 10th Street, and you see the masjid. You say, oh, let me do i'tikaf. You go through the parking lot and then you turn around and you go out and say, I did i'tikaf for 5 minutes. And even do tawaf too. Circle maybe 2-3 times. So it wouldn't be haram because 7 is according to the. They say 7 is the shirk, but if you do it less than 7 around the grave, it's not shirk. Yeah. So if you do 8 or 9, you're okay. Good. Do not cover around the tawaf around the grave 7 times, it's haram, shirk. But 4 times is not shirk.
More or less.
Yeah.
It's just difficult.
Why do we get into that stuff? Stop talking about this, please. So again, it's all shit, by the way. Whether you do it one time, whether you do it half time, whether you just go there and pay money to the grave, it's all shit, okay? Whether you do it about 7, 9, because I heard it wallahi from one of their great aqtam, big wali, wallah, I heard it with my own ears, wallah, and I saw it with my own eyes. He said, they told him, how come you guys do tawaf around the graves? He said, okay, have you seen them doing it? He said, wallah, I've seen it. It was in Egypt. He said, wallah, I've seen it with my own eyes. He said, how many times they go? He said, around 4 or 5. He said, how many times they go around Kaaba? He said, 7. He said, then that's it. So shirk is when you do 7. But other than 7, less or more, it's okay. It's all shirk. Okay? It's all shirk. But i'tikaf is different. I'tikaf, if you spend any time in the masjid, inshallah, i'tikaf will count. That's why a lot of people, for example, they come here, Ahmad, they sit in the masjid, صح? Between Maghrib and Isha. Every day, have the intention that this is i'tikaf. Have that intention, you're getting more reward. Not just, I'm sitting at the masjid, waiting for Isha. Well, that's good. That's a good thing, because if you're waiting for a salah, as if you're in the salah. So you're getting the reward as if you're praying. Get extra reward. Who doesn't need extra reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Everyone does. So anytime you spend in the masjid, make it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is no actual time. The okay. So i'tikaf, the sunnah, it can be fulfilled by staying in the masjid with the intention to make i'tikaf for as long or short time. The reward, of course, is according to how long you stay. Right? So someone who stay 1 hour is not like someone who stay 10 hours. Of course. You get reward for the more that you do, the more action that you do. If you sit in the masjid hoping for good, it's i'tikaf. Otherwise it's not. Meaning the one who performs i'tikaf has to have an intention. As we say, everything has to have an intention before you do it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would pray morning prayer and begin his i'tikaf. That's in the last 10 days of Ramadan. That's when he would begin his i'tikaf. What does he begin i'tikaf? Meaning he would enter the area of i'tikaf not to spend time in the masjid. Okay, pay attention to this. This is very important. Aisha radiallahu anha related that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Aisha related, if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam intend to make i'tikaf, he would pray the morning prayer and begin it. One time, he wanted to make i'tikaf during the last 10 nights of Ramadan, and he ordered his tent to be set up. Aisha reported, when I saw that, I ordered my tent to be set up, and some of the Prophet's wives followed the same thing that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. Rasulullah prayed the morning prayer, and he saw all these tents, and he said, what is this? They said, Ya Rasulullah, we are seeking obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. He ordered his tent and those of his wives to be taken down, and he delayed his i'tikaf to the first 10 days of Shawwal. That hadith shows that, number one, you could have a place in the masjid for your i'tikaf if you're not making any or causing any problem, or you're not causing a you're not taking a space from the masjid that people need. So can you have a tent in the masjid? Yes. And this is the sunnah. To have your tent in the masjid for i'tikaf. So it's private. You know how people they in i'tikaf they do, they come to the masjid, they spend some time. There are 5-6 of them. They sit, they talk, they laugh, they joke till Fajr. Then you'd be like, oh brother, what were you doing? Oh, mashallah, I was doing i'tikaf all night. That's not i'tikaf. That's playing around. Yes, it's okay to talk sometime. Feel free, sleep sometime, wake up sometime, pray sometime, read sometime. It's okay to mix, but not the whole time wasted. So Rasulullah would have that tent and a side of the masjid. And this, okay, Rasulullah would start, let's say he would start the night of, or the night of the 20th of Ramadan, he would be in the masjid. The morning after Fajr, he would go into the tent. But he's already in the masjid. Not that he started i'tikaf the first the morning. No, he started from the night. But he goes into his area where he would sit by himself. But when he saw his wife doing the same thing, and look, subhanAllah, look at the obedience. Rasulullah did not tell anybody to have a tent in the masjid. Rasulullah did not say, do the same way you saw me doing. But they followed Rasulullah because they just saw him doing the action. This is different between us and them now. Huh? We ask nowadays, what do we have? The first question, anybody ask you? Is it a sunnah? You say yes. JazakAllah. So are you gonna do it? Or you just said it's a sunnah. Oh, so you were asking for that? I thought you were asking, is it a sunnah so you could follow? A lot of people nowadays, they say, is it a sunnah, brother? Yes. MashaAllah, very good. Very good, you're gonna do it? No. Very good, I'm not going to do it because it's a sunnah. The Sahaba, this is not their case. The Sahaba, when they see Rasulullah doing something, they never ask, Ya Rasulullah, is it a sunnah? Should we do it or should we? What do you think? They just do it. If Rasulullah doesn't want them to do it, then he will say, don't do it because it was, I did it and he shouldn't do it. Like that. But they would follow the orders of Rasulullah without even asking questions. But when Rasulullah saw all these tents in the masjid, how would people pray then? If you have 20 tents in the masjid, how are you going to pray? There's no space. But if he's not going to take a space from the masjid, then you could have your own area. Like if this is my corner, I have my blanket in there, my pillow where I stay. So everybody knows that this is my area. Nobody should come and take the blanket like some people do. They take your stuff, put it in the middle of the masjid, and they pray there. Why did you do that, brother? Oh, I needed the space. SubhanAllah, look at the masjid. You have all this area, why are you taking my space? It's haram to take someone's space in the masjid if it's his. Haram. But he should not reserve a space in the masjid. Why? Because some people, even in Mecca, the people who went to Mecca, I went for Jum'ah, and they told me you cannot sit here. I was like, why? He said, that's reserved. Reserved for who? For people who are gonna come. So they send people like 2 hours before them. They come like 5 minutes before the sheikh is on the minbar. They come 5 minutes before him. And the guy's standing there. When he comes in, he sits in his place, then the other guy leaves. So he reserves a place for him. That's not allowed. Sheikh Nathabir Rahmanullah, the fatwa on this and the haram. You have to be there. So if I'm here, sitting down like now, I want to make wudu, I come back, you shouldn't sit in my place. But I shouldn't say, hey brother, like some people, they leave their hat, then they go out. Allah, they go out 2 or 3 hours, they come back, especially back home when we used to go, like Shaykh Muhammad Hassan and other Shaykh. MashaAllah, big number comes to the desk, like 1,000. So the brother will come asr, he would leave his pen and his Quran on there. And then he will go out. We're sitting from asr to Maghrib waiting for the Shaykh's lecture at Maghrib. And he just come like 5 minutes before Maghrib, that brother, hey, this is my area. Why? You see my pen in the Quran? What do you mean? You cannot do that. And the Sheikh, by the way, he mentioned it so many times. It's not, by the way, it's not sitting close to the Sheikh. You see, but nowadays the brother, because the Sheikh has been recorded, so they want to sit close to be on the TV. So they want to sit all the way here, and they're like waiting for the camera to turn. I've seen a lot of these people. They come, Maghrib is at 8 o'clock, wallah, they come 8:20. Sheikh usually comes late because he comes from Cairo. So 8:20, we finished praying, we were waiting for the Sheikh. Very crowded and like so difficult to find your place. I used to go asr and sit there, I wouldn't even move. We would send some brother to buy us some food to break our fast Thursday. And this brother would come from at 8:20 all the way from there. Hey, excuse me. And subhanAllah, the huge ones are the ones who come and you can't even tell them anything. You just have to say, okay, go ahead, brother. I reserve this for you. No. That's the only thing you could say to them. or else you're going to get yourself in trouble. So he says, Wallahi, I knew you were coming. Wallah, brothers, you know, make it easy. A brother came last time, mashallah. I think he's a... what did these call, people call? One who slaughtered the meat.
Butcher.
He came, blood all over the clothes. And he's coming, wallah, the clothes all the way up. And he's coming like... He came, and the sheikh was giving the dars already. So he came through, all the way to the front. And then he wanted to sit next to the sheikh. We were like, hey, like, what are you doing? We looked at him, we all did like, please, have a seat. You know, we reserved this just for you, baby God. We were afraid, blood all over. He killed somebody before he came, he's gonna kill us. So I said, okay, go ahead, brother. And the brother sat down next to the sheikh. After the sheikh finished the salah, a lot of people, they tried to go shake his hand and all that. And we do a circle around the sheikh to get him out of the crowd. That man, we could not stop him. We all said, okay, you want to see the sheikh? Go ahead. Wallah, they opened the door for him because the sheikh, he prays like this and there's a door here. So after he finished the Isha, he would go in and lock the door. Okay? That brother already pushed the door. Everybody looked at him and said, okay, bismillah. You want to talk to the sheikh? So he actually went and talked to him. I don't know, he had a problem with his business and all that. But the way he looked, you had to give him a space. Which is not allowed, especially in Jum'ah. Especially in Jum'ah. Rasulullah said you cannot cross over someone's shoulder during Jum'ah. So you come late, that's why I tell the brother, you come early to the masjid on Friday, why do you sit all the way back there? Sit in the front. So when people come late, they sit in the back. But then you see people come at 10 o'clock, they sit in the back. So I come at 11, where will they sit? In the front, so I have to cross over their shoulder, and this is not allowed by the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if you reserve a place for i'tikaf, it's allowed. As long as you're not taking a space from the masjid, as long as you're not causing any problems in the masjid, you have your own area for i'tikaf to do, it's okay and it's allowed as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did, and no one has the right to take that place from you. Okay? But of course, don't fight. Please. Don't fight the person who's staying there because he doesn't know. So try to teach him. To tell him, oh brother, this is my space and all that. Not to go like when I went somewhere with some brothers, okay? I was laying down, sleeping. And I was facing the Qibla. The brother, jazakallah khair, he think, I don't know if he has a hadith or no proof, till now I couldn't find one, that you cannot sleep your feet facing the Qibla, meaning laying down facing the Qibla, because it's disrespect, okay? That's what it is, but not hadith, okay? So what did the brother do? 2 o'clock in the morning, he came, he took me, he turned me around. You know, if somebody come close to me, just if I hear a footstep, I wake up. That's me. So brother took me and went, so I looked up, it's like maybe either two things, in Jannah and already taken away, I died, or something, or I did something wrong, like, and I was like, what's going on? It's 2 o'clock. He said, you cannot sleep facing the Qibla. I was like, okay, could you wait till the morning to tell me that? Really? How? I cannot go back to sleep that easily now. Tell me in the morning, I know Allah would do it. I would not face the Qibla again, but not wake me up during the night. So that's why you have to have some wisdom in giving da'wah. When you see somebody doing something wrong, and you know it's wrong, try to be nice. And try to explain to them first before attacking them. Nobody likes someone to come and say, hey, you're wrong. Well, you're wrong too. Without even a proof. Okay? So i'tikaf, number one, there's no time, meaning to spend, unless it's obligatory. Number two, highly recommended in the last 10 days of Ramadan to spend in the masjid as much as you can, even as Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah said, even if it's a length of approximately 20 minutes, according to Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, that's the length. You know that the hadith when they say Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did that for an hour, it's not the hour that we know of now. Just to let you know, the hadith, it doesn't mean an hour like 1 hour from 2 to 3. No, it means most of the time, the length from a person getting the goat, slaughtering the goat, cleaning it up, and then it's ready. That's the length of time. So that might take what, an hour and a half, 2 hours? That's approximately the length that the ulama would say. So any time that you can spend in the masjid, any time, do it for the sake of Allah. Have the intention that this is i'tikaf, meaning I'm spending that time just for that purpose of i'tikaf, to spend that time for the sake of Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the reward for it. What are the conditions of i'tikaf? What's the difference between a condition and a pillar? What's the difference between a condition and a pillar? That's why, remember when we had the fundamentals of fiqh? Alhamdulillah, that helped a lot. A nice hadith from Shabab. Go ahead. It wasn't you. Hadith from Shabab. Okay, go ahead. You are the first one to raise your hand.
Condition is something that's before the actual act of worship, and pillar is actually when you're doing the act of worship.
Good. Condition comes before the worship. A pillar is during the worship. So condition is a must before. Like wudu is a condition of prayer, right? Condition of prayer, right? Condition, because it comes before. Pillar is like takbiratul ihram, ruku', sujood, all these. Tayyib. The one who performs i'tikaf must be a Muslim adult. So this is the first thing, Muslim. And we said, from the time that he starts i'tikaf, he has to be a Muslim. When he starts. Not that he's in the masjid, okay, can a disbeliever, or a kafir, or whatever, can he spend time in the masjid?
Yeah.
Yes, you can. Because Rasulullah ﷺ, when they captured Thumama, he was the leader of his group, and he was a kafir at that time, disbeliever. And Rasulullah, they tied him to the tree in the masjid for 3 days. So that's allowed for a non-Muslim to enter the masjid as long as he respects the rules of the masjid. So he shouldn't step with his shoe into the area and be like, oh, we do that our home. Doesn't matter, that's not your home. Or he wants to go to a woman area and look at them and see who's in there and all that. If he doesn't respect the conditions of the masjid, then he shouldn't enter the masjid. But is he allowed to enter the masjid? Yes. And mostly the ulama says for a benefit. Except, of course, Mecca and Medina now. But for the benefit, meaning not just to enter the masjid and he has, mashallah, corona in his hand, he's sitting back there, listening to the dars and drinking. You'd be like, the brother is learning about Islam. No, he has to throw that away first, then come to the masjid. There are some things that he has to respect as a non-Muslim when he enters a masjid. But a Muslim who wants to do i'tikaf, number one, the first condition, sorry, has to be a Muslim. Adult, well, he's saying that, we already talked about this before, the difference between a kid's action and an adult's action. A kid's action is preferred to do but is not obligatory. Is he getting reward for doing it? Yes. Adult's action is obligatory, if it's obligatory, and he's getting reward for it. And if he misses it, he has to make it up. But a kid doesn't have to make it up. Now. If a non-Muslim woman come to the masjid, she also has to follow the rule of the masjid. And this is very important. For a sister, for all the sisters, if you're in the women area, and you have a non-Muslim around, you should not take your hijab off. Or show any of your parts to a non-Muslim, because she is considered to be stranger, like a man, to a woman. This is a very important rule. Even among Muslim women. Sometimes they go to a party, or they, you know, these wedding party, mashallah, they come in dark black, they go in white. They take everything off. This is not allowed. This is not allowed. Why? For the harm behind it. Even if there is no proof Let's just say there is proof, but let's say there is no proof. There's harm behind it. The main harm is Rasulullah said, a woman would describe another woman to her husband as if he could see her. So she goes home, she's sitting down. You know, this lady, so-and-so's husband, then she starts describing him as if the man could imagine how does she look like. This is haram. So some women, they don't care about this. They go to a wedding party or when they get together, they just take their clothes off and they no, be careful of that. The private parts for a woman, to a stranger woman, meaning a non-Muslim, is as the private part to a woman and a man. They're getting together. So if a Muslim woman is sitting down here, how would she be dressed? Except for the niqab, that has a difference between the ulama. The niqab, can she take off the niqab if there's a stranger woman in there, meaning a non-Muslim stranger woman is there or not? And that difference is accepted. I'm not talking about niqab, I'm talking about taking off the hijab and showing part of her shoulders and all that stuff. That's not allowed. Tamam? At least for the harm. Especially nowadays. Weddings, when they go, what do they do? Cameras. So she's taking off, she looks nice. She's going around. Then she go home, her husband is taking the phone, he's playing with it. She didn't mean to show him, but he's playing with it. Okay. Is that allowed? No. So that harm, and remember the story in Saudi Arabia. Who remember? Remember in Saudi Arabia, there's a fatwa that came out that says using a phone with a camera is haram. And everybody was like, oh, look at the Saudis, the Wahhabis, they're saying cameras are haram. Hold on. The thing is, there was a wedding, and some of the women who bought, at that time, if you had the phone with the camera, you're like a Bill Gates guy at that in Saudi Arabia, they considered that. So when they had the first phone, they took it to the wedding. And there was some of the ruler's daughters there and family, and they've been recorded. And you know how in Saudi, and like our countries, they go in, mashallah, fully covered. You cannot see a thing, not even the eyes. If you go in and you look inside, everything. They take everything off. And then they enjoy their time. So somebody was recording and he had it on YouTube and they had to pay money to buy the tape and all that stuff. So the ulama said, this is not just for the royal family, it's for all Muslims. It has to be that rule. And that's why in wedding now they take the phone out, the phone from you before you go in. Even in haram, they take the phone from the women before they go into Medina. And they keep it in the same place for them.
What I mean is a non-Muslim woman can stay in the masjid without
hijab. Yeah, she could stay in the masjid without a hijab if she's in a woman area. But for the respect of the masjid, she should cover her. But you cannot force her. Because if you tell a woman who's non-Muslim to wear a hijab, it's not obligatory. So how could you tell her to do something that's not obligatory? Like a non-Muslim, a Christian person coming with you to a masjid, you don't tell him, oh brother, you have to stand in line with us and pray. It's not obligatory yet upon him until he revert to Islam and then he has to pray. Before that, you have no control over him. You advise them but not force them. Got it? But if she's among men, you have to tell her. In our religion, women when they come to a masjid, they do that and this, so they would know, they would be aware. If a woman wants to revert to Islam, she wants to become a Muslim, you have to tell her, a lot of people don't do that. They say, you're going to tell her from the first day to wear hijab? Yes, because this is Islam. If she doesn't agree with that, then she cannot become a Muslim. Oh, Sheikh, literally just become Muslim, then we'll take care of that later. No, it has to be the first day. Like a person who comes in, hey brother, you have to pray five times. Too hard than him. Wait till he become a Muslim, see what we're doing, then he would like it. Well, if he doesn't pray, then he's not a Muslim. So if they don't accept their religion as it is, then there is no benefit, there is no point of them becoming Muslim. Sometimes, I don't know why Muslims are going too loose with these things. They'll be like, yes, let them become Muslim first, then we'll talk about, we'll tell them there's Salah, there's Siyam, there's Zakat. But if you tell them from the first day, we fast 30 days, they'll be like, no, we're not becoming Muslim. So not to scare them, get them in first and then, so you're going to trick them? You became Muslim now? One second, there's five prayers, the brother, you didn't tell me. I was waiting until you become Muslim. That's Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the first thing he told Mu'adh radiallahu anhu when he sent him to Yemen, what did he tell him? He said, tell them that they have to worship one God. If they agree with that, then tell them that Allah had made five prayers obligatory. If they agree on that, to show them. If they disagree, then that's the deen, that's the religion. If we don't hold on to it, then nobody else is going to hold on to it. So becoming a Muslim adult, of course, a woman, for the rule of the ulama said, does he have to be pure? Of course he has to be pure. At least not have wudu, which is recommended to have wudu because the angels, they're going to be around. But when you're sitting in the masjid, you should have wudu. But they're talking about purification, meaning for any reason, okay? Sexual relation, with dream, any reason. Or for a woman, if she's bleeding, if she has blood after birth, or during her period time, then they cannot stay in the masjid. They cannot stay at the masjid. Not that, oh Shaykh, Ramadan only comes once a year, this 10 days I'm gonna be 1 week off, and please let me come to the masjid. You're not allowed to come to the masjid. That's it. A woman cannot come to the masjid during her period time, unless for Eid prayer, and she has to stay away from the area where people pray. Because Rasulullah ﷺ told them that. Other than that, do i'tikaf at your house. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the women not to pray, and it's the prayer is the most important pillar of our deen, then anything else comes after that, she shouldn't do. So she shouldn't say, I feel good when I read Quran, even though I'm going through my period and all that. If you cannot pray, then you cannot read Quran. Unless a woman is a teacher and she has to review and all that has conditions. We don't go into that right now. So you have to stay in the masjid. You have to be pure from anything that makes you impure, okay? And it's not accepted from disbeliever or a young boy, which is better to bring him to the masjid. And it's not accepted from women during her period or women bleeding after birth. And so on and so on. So these are the conditions. Muslim, pure, and of course we're going to talk about the masjid, which is not agreed condition upon the scholars, but inshallah we'll take about 5 minutes break and then we'll continue. Yeah? Then 5 minutes break, then we'll continue inshallah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.